Welcome back. In studio now, we have a political analyst, Isabel Diaz. Thank you so much for being here to discuss Ecuador a bit more with us. Let's start with what's going on right now. You were at the protest. I was also at the protest a little earlier. Police have been clearing people away from the center of Quito, mm-hmm. where the large demonstrations were held, and also away from the National Assembly area. What did you see when you were last there?
Exactly that. I left there about 2 hours ago, and they were the strikers and the protesters were being met by brutal repression by the police and by the military. So it's really hard to believe that there are any dialogues being held if you face that kind of repression in the streets.
Absolutely. And there are a lot of different organizations that are on the ground there. Mm-hmm. I think I'm not really sure if the international media is understanding how wide-ranging the groups mm-hmm. are there. We have Indigenous groups, and we've been hearing a lot more about that lately because they've been coming from out of town. We have some other smaller political groups, some political party-affiliated groups. Tell us a little bit about what the different interests are that these groups have.
Of course. Obviously, the main actor is the Indigenous movement. However, since the very first day of the protest, you had many groups gathering in the streets. You had feminist movements, ecologists, students, obviously, they've played a major role, workers, obviously, but also people associated with the Citizens' Revolution and other forces. So I think you can say that what is happening is that somehow a popular bloc is forming in the streets. However, you cannot deny that the major actor is CONAIE.
Absolutely. And what has been the role of the Citizens' Revolution in this? Because, of course, they're one of the voices that we hear on the news, and they have a very large platform. And they're also in the city of Quito, in the city of Guayaquil, in major cities. So we hear a lot from these politicians, but it seems like now they're taking a back seat. What has been their role?
Yeah. I believe it's important to understand that the Citizens' Revolution has been denouncing the treaty with the IMF from the very beginning. They are actually the only political force that has seats in the National Assembly that has spoken up against the measures taken by the government. However, obviously, after CONAIE took the streets of Quito, they've taken a step back, I'd said, because as we all know, there's been some kind of a fight. The problem is that the president, he's constantly trying to endorse the whole unrest and the violence to Korea and the leaders of his movement. So they are trying to, they've responded. Today, Paola Pavón, which is the prefecta of Pichincha, she actually said that if there are any charges to be held against her, that she will come and report for that. However, that hasn't happened yet.
Absolutely. And we've seen that there has been limited coverage internationally of what's been going on, or, you know, the telling of only one side. Tell us about the coverage here in the media in Ecuador.
I think the alternative digital platforms have played a major role for keeping people informed. Because as you know, the mass media here in Ecuador, at the national level, they've all backed the government and they are not really telling us what's going on in the streets. Yesterday, for example, Pichincha Universal, which was a major radio station here, was shut down. And it was actually the only radio station that was transmitting live what was going on in the streets.
Wow, that's absolutely very serious. Another thing that the government is saying is that external forces have actually been behind these protests. I myself was on the ground. Participants are, of course, 100% Ecuadorian from different parts of the country, mostly from Pichincha, of course. What have you seen as far as the government attempting to place blame elsewhere?
Yeah, I think that's just the way they found in order to keep, because what they've been saying all these days is that protests are just criminals, mafia, and so on, gangs. They don't want to accept the fact that people, Ecuadorians from all over the country, are going out to the streets to protest for their rights. Actually, today, I believe, in midday, the vice president came out and said that they had military intelligence saying that there were lots of foreigners taking part in the protests and causing violence, and that if any foreigners were to be found there, they will be deported, which I believe are really serious declarations, you know? And it also brings a wave of racism, xenophobia, that's really dangerous for Ecuador, which is normally a peaceful country, welcoming of foreigners.
Absolutely. And can you explain to us a little bit about the dialogue that the president is offering, and do you think anyone's going to take that offer?
I think it's really hard to believe in any kind of dialogue when you have a state of emergency that was declared only after 4 hours of protests, you know? That means military is controlling the streets right now. Many of our civil rights have been suspended. For example, we don't have a right to assembly right now. So long the government doesn't take the state of emergency back, it's really hard to believe that they are really willing to open up any dialogue. Also, they say they want to open up channels of dialogue with CONAIE, and at the same time they are saying they are not willing to bring back the full subsidies and reconsider any other of the reforms. So that's really worrying. We don't see any grounds for compromise there.
Absolutely. So we have a state of exception. This curfew is being strictly enforced right now. And, you know, like you said, the right of assembly, the right to demonstrate is questionable. What do you think is going to happen tomorrow?
We really don't know, because as you said, like, the government is trying to say now they are talking with CONAIE, but 2 hours ago they were still trying to like take them out from the streets with like lots of brutal repression by the police. So I believe unless the people that's responsible for the repression takes a step down from office, we cannot go back. They have to be held responsible for what they have done. We have, I believe, 6 people that are dead right now. That's something that Ecuador hasn't seen in years. I mean, I think we've experienced more than 3 presidents being taken out of office. And in all those times, we only one person died. And now, only after 1 week of protest, we have already 6 people dead.
An extraordinary series of events that's happening here. Thank you so much for being with us, Isabel Diaz, political analyst. You're welcome back anytime to explain more about what's going on in Ecuador. After the break, we'll look at the latest stories in the Caribbean. Stay with us.